In my 22 years on this earth, this might be the best year for music. Hello everyone and welcome back to the New Music Podcast. We've got a packed week for you this time around. The music gods have blessed us with lots to talk about. We got 6 albums. There's going to be timestamps down below us right now if you want to skip to any particular one. Otherwise, you can check the list in the description below. Micah, do you want to tell them what the first one we have for the week is?
All right, we have Lil Yachty and James Blake in Bad Cameo.
I love her so we neighbors. My sister cook with flavor. It's sweet but then it's savor. He had if you love me, let me know. I'm going crazy. Baby, count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
Yes, we do. How do you feel about it?
Good cameo.
Good cameo. Okay.
All right. What's a lot to say about this album, next album of?
Yeah, no, it's pretty great, isn't it?
It is a banger. I was listening to it while mowing the lawn for the first time, and I was like, hey, it's pretty good.
That seems like the worst possible setting for this. Are you sure?
You know, it's a terrible setting, but it's even good in bad settings.
Yeah.
I didn't know Lil Yachty had it in him in 2023, and I didn't know he had it in him in 2024, but here we are.
Do you mean 2021? I believe that's when... Or no. No, what? Oh.
No, let's start here. This last year, dog.
What? Whoa. I'm having a moment with this right now. Why do I feel like Let's Start Here is so much older than it is? That's so weird.
It's because it's so good.
Seeing him actually follow it up with something that's equally decent is pretty fucking crazy.
I loved the last album. Like, I used to just not give a fuck about Lil Yachty. And then he starts dropping good shit.
Right.
Like, man, last album was, like, in my top 10, I think, for albums of that year.
You know, I have no idea where it landed, and I might not have even ranked it, because I didn't think that it came out last year. I'm not sure if I did when I was making my list or not. That's so weird to me that it's not even 2 years old, but to follow it up so quickly too is also very impressive. I mean, I know this is a collaborative effort, but that was kind of his magnum opus of that time, whereas honestly this might be even better.
I disagree. I liked Let's Start Here just a little better, but I mean, it still has time to grow on me.
Yeah, I've given it a lot of time, but I don't know. Right out the gate, I think I might have liked it better, too.
Well, no, I love this album. Don't get me wrong. This album's really good. But I can't really think of any problems with it. It just feels right that the last one's better. I'm trying to figure out how to critique this album, man. But it's fun. It does what it's supposed to do.
Yeah.
I had nothing really negative to say.
Yeah. It really takes you on a whole little journey all the way through, honestly. Like, it is such a good album to just sit down with it on and just kind of like just sink into all the sounds. Even just in the first few seconds, you got those like chimes and this kind of spacey atmosphere, and then it builds up slowly, and then you get those fucking bass hits that come in there that are just like so potent. And I feel like that's the moment where this whole crazy atmosphere starts, and then it doesn't really let up from there. Like I'm just in there for the remainder of the project.
Yeah, dude, I get eat. And then in the song Midnight, the way he mixed these lyrics in here, it scratched my brain real good.
For sure.
Like,
yeah,
I don't know what made him start doing like ambient psychedelic stuff, but please don't stop.
Yeah.
For love of God.
No, this is so much better. It's really funny because he was doing the trajectory that most of the other SoundCloud rappers did, where like they're making some bangers that are kind of classic now, but then they just trailed off into making some fucking dog shit. And then yeah, we had Let's Start Here, and now it seems like this is what he's going with. Like, this is what is going to be continued here, and it's so nice. It's like an entirely different artist. It's amazing.
Lil Yachty 2 just dropped.
Yeah, Lil Yachty 2 from 2023 onwards is pretty fucking awesome.
Do you have any like least favorite moments or any like bad things to say about this album? Because I know I don't.
To be quite honest with you, the only thing that's stopping it from being perfect for me is Run Away from the Rabbit, just because I think that it does a little bit less than the rest of the album before it. Basically, the rest of the songs are either almost perfect or perfect to me. That one just seems a little bit more tame, if that makes any sense. Like, it doesn't feel like it has as strong of an atmosphere. Still got some of those like poetic lyrics, and it all just kind of washes in nicely, but just a little bit less of an interesting track to me.
It's fair. I can understand that. It didn't hit perfect for me because I felt like there was just a little more, like, I know he's just got a little more in him. He's gonna pull something out of his ass and drop a 10 next year or some shit.
I could see it, maybe. This has just sat with me long enough that I can't really say anything bad about it. I've played this album a lot of times this week, and every time I really just leave with no complaints whatsoever.
Same.
Do you have, like, favorite tracks? Because I'll definitely point out a few as well.
Yeah, Midnight's my favorite. I really did like the opener, too.
Yeah. Both really great ones. I don't... I know I just said this now, but I'm looking through here and I'm like, what do I even pick as my favorite? I think Twice, maybe.
That's fair.
Yeah, such a good fucking song, man. I feel like that one just goes the extra mile. Like, it's all trippy and crazy. Definitively has two parts, which then ties into the title, and it all sounds so great, and the lyrics are awesome. It's just such a good fucking song, man. And so are the rest of them, I guess, but Missing Man is excellent too, but I could say most of the same things.
Hell yeah.
Into some poetic lyrics all throughout, and I enjoyed that quite a lot as well. The writing seems pretty solid.
Yeah, dude, everything about it is just like vibes. Vibe City, population, me.
Yeah. Are you at all familiar with James Blake?
No.
No? Okay. I feel like the front and center focus is still kind of on Lil Yachty, just because he did subvert everyone's expectations so much. And this is a little bit more normal for James Blake, but I would say that he's, from what I've heard, he's over stuff that's not quite this like psychedelic and ethereal and stuff, but him singing and doing this kind of R&B type performance is pretty normal for him. But I think their vocal chemistry works surprisingly well. What do you think?
Oh, yeah. Lil Yachty's weird-ass voice.
Right.
Just sounds nice next to James Blake. Like, I just get lost in it. Like, even on Run Away From the Rabbit.
For sure.
Which is a track I'll just really quick to make to see if that was my least favorite. It just works.
Right. And you wouldn't expect it to, but it is kind of nice having Lil Yachty, who has, like, a more unique voice that's not as technically proficient, next to James Blake, who's just like a really great singer. It kind of balances things out in my eyes, I guess.
Hell yeah.
This is one of my favorites of the year, I'm gonna be completely honest with you, so I feel like I should have more to say.
Dude, it's up there.
Yeah.
It's up there with me too. It just, it eats you too much, and that's just pretty much it.
Right.
You gotta say about it. Real quick, side note, side tangent, probably don't put this in the episode, but why the fuck did Anthony Fantano give it a 50?
I haven't actually watched the review yet, to be honest with you. I'm sad and disappointed about the score. But I'm sure he has his reasons.
Common melano.
Yeah. I'm, at this point, man, I'm just so frustrated because, like, he can have his own opinions. It's fine. Like, let the dude like what he likes and dislike what he dislikes.
Can have mine.
But the only thing we're on the same page with is Knocked Loose, because he has given really mid scores to both of the Blade albums, Kamasi Washington, Glass Beach.
He gave Charlie XCX a 10.
Yeah. Okay. We're kind of on the same page there, but, like, most of the stuff this year that I love, I'm like, no, don't do this to me.
You're washed.
I don't know, man. You know, and it's fine, but it's just a little bit sad every time.
Psychos dropped down to a 70 and Cold Visions dropped down to a 75.
That's depressing, but not necessarily related. But yeah, this one's just an experience. It's so good to listen to. What'd you think of Woo? Because I feel like that's the most debated on quality of the tracks here.
It was good.
It's good.
It's good. It was right after midnight, so I was just like, whoa.
Yeah. That one has grown on me the most. I think that it's cool that they mixed in a song here that's more of like a traditional rap song and just kind of works like one, but it's still all like psychedelic and crazy and shit.
Yeah, I'll allow it.
When the chorus comes back in towards the end there, I just like actually get chills, and that doesn't happen that much on here. I'm usually just immersed in vibing, but I think that one's like so climactic and cool. It makes me sad when people don't like it as much, but I understand it. Again, kind of same thing as Fantano, what he's saying. It's like, I understand that you don't like it, but can you instead start liking it? please.
Yeah, please.
All right. What did you end up scoring this?
90.
90? I went with a 96 on this.
Holy shit. If I put this at a 96, it'd be my third best album.
I'm just handing them out like candy, bro. I'm not even lying to you. It's my fourth. It's my fourth. And it's tied with Death's Dynamic Shroud, so I guess that's not that bad.
Dude, I have 1, 2, 3. I have 8 albums that are above a 90 and 2 EPs this year.
Gotcha. Okay. I am glad that I didn't just come in here and you were going to be like, nope, don't get this one, don't like it. I'm glad that wasn't the case, because there was a little part of me that was worried.
I loved the last one.
Well, yeah. I think you might have actually loved Let's Start Here more than I did. I know that I listened to it before you, and I was like, nah, you actually got to check this out.
Oh, I rated Let's Start Here at a 90.
At a 90? I'm not sure what I gave it. Let me see. Oh, I gave it a 91.
Oh shit.
Yeah, that seems about right looking back.
Show me
looking back for me though too. It's definitely that solid, I think. I think we can move on then to Samurai by Lupe Fiasco. Before she could depart, he reached up and grabbed her, sent the post off the chart, said everything you do will now be in another art. I've won many things I've done, but this one here.
Ew, this album.
You didn't like it?
No, I loved it. It was so good. It was perfect.
Yeah, man, for sure. I was gonna say, it's really fucking good. In my 22 years on this earth, this might be the best year for music.
Same.
Yeah.
In my 23 years.
Yeah. Honestly, like, this shit's fucking fantastic, dude. I don't even know how much there is to say about this one, because it's just kind of like, it's 30 minutes and like 9 songs, right?
Pick a bad track in there.
Am I counting that right?
8 tracks.
There's 8 tracks and they're all just so solid. He's just doing his raps over these really slick jazz rap instrumentals. It's just vibes, bro.
Yeah, I don't have a ton to say about it either. It's just fucking good. Turn on, dude. I don't know. What are you doing?
Yeah.
I've heard a lot of rap, like jazz rap like this. And out of all the jazz rap, this is really good jazz rap. If you like this kind of music, listen to this.
Totally.
Better than most of it out there.
I would say so, yeah. He's really coming through with such solid flows on here. Like, he always just sounds so sharp on these songs.
Yeah, I'm looking at other, like, artists that are in this, like, genre. And, yeah, this guy's one of the better ones, easily.
For sure, for sure. I honestly haven't really listened to a lot of his older stuff, have you?
No, this is my first time listening to a Lupe Fiasco project. He was on Nerd's album, Seeing Sounds.
Yeah.
So I've heard, he's on Late Registration, I heard him there.
I know that he's had, like, some hit songs that have been big as well, so.
Yeah.
He's somebody where you definitely have heard of him, at least, but I don't think I've ever sat down and listened to a whole album. I've been really meaning to check out Food and Liquor, because people say really great things about that one, for sure. Definitely will be doing that. It's just, it was a packed week. I meant to go back and check it out, so I had a point of comparison, but still.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, based on the consensus, this is close to his best album.
Yeah, that's what it looks like. Oh my god.
Yeah. And we have a career here spanning back 18 years at least, if not more, so that's pretty fucking impressive. Good for him.
Yeah, dude. Hell yeah.
I feel like this type of artist gets really washed at some point most of the time, but like, nah, he still sounds super sharp. Like, he's on it.
I'm looking back, the earliest thing I found was 2003. So 21 years.
Yeah. Pretty impressive. Like, I mean, and I guess you could just kind of look at it as he's been honing his skills this whole time rather than falling off, but that's definitely the better thing to do.
Yeah, no, dude, very good album is very good.
Yeah. I think it still makes sense to, like, pick a least favorite and a favorite. Like, what do you got as far as that goes?
My favorite's probably the opener, Samurai.
Okay.
And if I had to pick a least favorite, I don't know.
You don't know?
my lowest rated track were Bigfoot and Outside.
Okay, yeah, I'm totally with you.
But, like, it's still rated good.
Yeah. I think that Samurai is a great one for sure. Honestly, my favorite is probably Mumble Rap, just because I love the storytelling.
That
I wasn't
really
expecting
good.
Him to pull out storytelling that was, like, that solid, you know? And I mean, it totally makes sense that he can do storytelling really well. It's just so nice on that song, and it's very catchy. I was so glad that it wasn't a song like shitting on mumble rap, because he's a lyrical rapper. That's almost what I was anticipating. I was like, oh no, it's gonna be one of those, you know? But no, it's playing into how the chorus sounds, and I think that that's really clever too, you know?
Hell yeah, dude.
Yeah.
That one was pretty close. That one was up there for me, but
yeah.
What was your overall score?
I went with a 91% on here.
91? Holy shit.
Yeah, what'd you go with?
I landed on 85.
Dude, I'm telling you, man. So many things come out this year, and I'm just like, no fucking way this exists. That's awesome.
Here you go.
Yeah, no, for real. Like, and it always feels, maybe not so much quite this week, but it feels like things keep coming out that are just exactly what I want to be listening to at every given point as well. So that's always fucking crazy too. God, dude, I'm just so down for it. It's amazing.
Hell yeah.
But
I believe we have Camila Cabello, C comma XOXO.
Cards right, wrist, make them come. Let me grip by your money maker, okay. Grip by your money maker, okay.
Yeah, we sure fucking do.
Shit sucked.
Jesus Christ. In my 22 years of living, this might be the worst year for music I've ever seen.
Do you think this is worse than Slut Pop Miami?
No, I don't. But I was just saying, like, you know, I mean, I'm obviously joking and or exaggerating slightly in both regards, but like, it's so weird the contrast here, because this is fucking hot garbage, and we're hot off the heels of talking about two fucking amazing albums just a second ago. What are your thoughts? Give me your thoughts.
Man, I wish this album was gone.
Yeah, like, it just doesn't need to exist.
Bad album is bad
conceptually, like, down to the core here. Like, what are we working with, man? Okay,
oh, Drake's in this album.
What the fuck, you didn't notice he has two features, brother? Did you listen to this?
I did I just tried not to.
How did you miss the fact that there's just a Drake song on here? Like, it's not even look at the track list. It just says it's by Drake. It's not even her anymore.
Are you trying to tell me you expect me to remember this album?
Yeah, it's kind of fucking terrible, but like, in a somewhat memorable way.
That's true. I heard Drake, and I just didn't want to admit that it was Drake. Okay, also in my defense, I've only ever heard like two or three Drake songs, and two of them were the fucking diss tracks.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, I forgot that you had somehow avoided Drake all of your life. Which doesn't make a lot of sense, but it was in fact the case.
I'm happier for it.
Yeah. Fuck, bro. No, two Drake features, and one of them is just like a interlude length song that is just a Drake song. So that's a great look. What's also a great look is the fact that he's doubling down so hard on the accents. Like, he's doing this whole exaggerated Jamaican accent on both of those tracks, and it sounds fucking ridiculous.
What is Lil Nas X doing here?
Yeah, I really wish he wouldn't.
What did you appear in? This is trash.
Yeah, man. I do really feel like I should expect him to just be on better things. Because, I don't know, man. He is probably the best part of this album, though. I don't know. There's a few other, like, tolerable moments for sure that are just normal-ish sounding pop songs. His section here was decently enjoyable. Playboi Carti's feature, I don't think you had already heard I Love It, so what'd you think of that opening track here?
Yeah, I was listening to it, and then I was like, okay, maybe this isn't so bad. And I didn't look at the ratings first, so I was like, all right, this could be like a fun little thing going on. And then Playboi Carti's first came on.
If we're going to bring up Fantano again so soon, unfortunately, I feel like I got to give credit where it's due here and not pretend that this was my original thought, but he described Playboi Carti on here as sounding like a Minecraft villager.
Yeah.
And I thought that that was the funniest fucking shit.
That's fair. Dude, this shit made me want to keep like a crashed car. I turned it off right away. Not going to lie.
Oh, man. Yeah, like, when it came on the playlist, and every time that opening track, I'm just like, it's the most fucking annoying shit. I'm sorry, dude. That is maybe like the most annoying chorus, though.
I'm gonna keep it real. My least favorite track is I Love It.
I don't know. Me too, kind of, but...
Just because of the shock, though. The shock and all. I mean, Drake is there, so, like, he deserves it, but...
Yeah.
I don't know, man. Just the absolute, like, terror in my face when I heard Playboi Carti going, wah, 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 wah.
I'll say this, like, every time he kind of switches his sound, he was doing the, like, baby voice mumble rap thing at first, and then he switched to his, like, fucking vampire-style thing that he did on Whole Lotta Red, and now he's doing this, like, Minecraft villager flow. Every time, it's shocking and strange that he switched it up in the way that he did, but it's interesting-ish, I guess, but it also just sounds fucking terrible. But maybe we'll all collectively warm up to it. It's hard to say.
No, thank you.
To actually listen to, yeah, that might be my least favorite, because, yeah, also that chorus just makes me want to fucking rip my ears out.
Love it.
No, dude, shut.
Stop loving it.
Yeah, do something else. Pretty When I Cry is tolerable, but I feel like she's trying to steal Lana Del Rey's swag entirely. Charlie XCX is the other artist that we can obviously point to as kind of being ripped off here. This coming so shortly after Brat and also doing the whole halfway hyperpop thing.
Every masterpiece has its cheap knockoff.
Honestly, dude. Like, I understand that this was in the works for a long time, but just Charlie XCX's entire ethos and how she makes music and everything feels like it's being ripped here, because it's like doing a half-assed hyperpop thing.
So someone who's never listened to hyperpop trying to make hyperpop.
It feels like somebody trying to ride a wave to me. That's what I get from it, at least. It's like, this is here because hyperpop is trendy. But honestly, like, it's kind of on its way out, too, which just makes it start feeling dated, like, straight out the gate.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because, I don't know, you listen to, like, Chanel No. 5 is definitely trying a hyperpop thing. So is I Love It, to an extent, I guess. It's just fucking failing at it. Some of the later songs on here, well, what's really weird is I think that the ones that aren't even really songs and are just more interludes are some of the best-sounding songs on here.
Because it's gone so fast.
Well, I don't know, like Pink XOXO, I wasn't paying attention to the runtime, and I'm like, oh, this is probably going to be a pretty okay song, and then it's just done.
Thank God.
I mean, I don't know, dude. And then BLP Kosher, what the fuck, dude? Like, he's not even an actual feature on a song. Like, he's just here, like, dick riding the album. It kind of makes me feel less of him, to be honest with you. Again, like what you like, but to just show up on this album and be like, yeah, I really like this album, that's my feature, like, what? What is happening, bro? Koshi XOXO, yeah.
I'm looking at who BLP Kosher is.
Oh, are you not at all familiar with him? He's no. Kind of a niche rapper. He's got a whole shtick about him and everything, but...
I see the shtick. It's a funny shtick.
Yeah, no, and he's great. I like his music for sure, but this made me so disappointed. I'm like, oh man, you're really gonna show up here and just do this? Nothing else? Like,
he's a paid actor, dog.
Paid actor? Dude, I wouldn't fucking doubt it, because he's like, I cry to this album. Like, what did you cry to?
It was so bad it drove him to tears.
Like, it doesn't make any sense, brother. Like, what are you off about? If this is what's inspiring your future music, then it's probably gonna be quite bad. I'm sorry. I don't know, man. I'm trying to say something nice here and there, so I'm not just entirely being a hater, but at the same time...
No, fuck this album, dude. Yeah. Fuck this album cover, too.
Yeah, the album cover's also annoying. I hate this facial expression, but...
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, man. And then I'm looking through this track list again. Like, 20-somethings is on here. That song makes me want to fucking die. Fuck all that, dude. Hey,
there's we've so given much, us enough screen time.
There's so much bad to say, dude. It's just,
we gotta talk about. We gotta talk about the album of the year after this.
All right, what'd you end up scoring it?
20.
23 from me. I really thought that I was gonna be the lower of the two of us. I was trying to be reasonable.
No, I was reasonable. I wrote a review and everything. I said, why?
Just why?
Just why?
The summarization in my notes that I wrote at the end, I just said, what a fucking mess. So I'm basically on the same page as you, honestly.
Oh, dude, why is the same review I gave to Masturbate in Praise of Black Satan?
God, that fucking album.
All right, that's good.
Well, anyways, let's move on to the album of the year, Loom by Imagine Dragons. Take a chainsaw out and feed it. It's way too cold. My heart is cold enough. There's fire in these hills, and I think I've lost the will.
Hell yeah, dude. dude. Imagine Dragons with their seventh studio album.
Yeah.
Loom.
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 You said you went on a little bit of a deep dive adventure with Imagine Dragons this past week. Tell me about it.
Yeah, it's all bad.
Pretty much.
It's consistently trash. They've released the same album again, and it sucks. That is all.
I have my nostalgia blinders on for Night Visions. It's probably not as good as I remember. Same thing with Smoke and Mirrors. But when those came out, let's see. In my defense, I would have been 12 at the most when Smoke and Mirrors came out. I liked them a lot, but I haven't exactly wanted to come back to them in my adult life, I'll say that much. Evolve, I kind of sort of liked a little bit at the time and have grown to despise it. It was just disappointing to start with. Origins is their lowest rated album, and I am afraid to ever listen to it. And then Mercury Act 1 was interesting back in 2021 because I think there's a few good songs on it. Like Wrecked on there, I think is still their best song for sure. But then, Mercury Act 2 was bad. And now this is maybe my least favorite because, again, I don't remember anything about Origins if I've ever even listened to it at all. But this drives me fucking insane, dude.
The first track, it's just, it sets the tone.
God, it's so shit, dude. When he's doing the, sounds, the chainsaw sounds, you
chainsaw.
Know what I
mean? Chainsaw.
Yeah! No, but you know what I mean? I don't even want to imitate it, brother. It makes my fucking skin crawl.
Yeah, I'm gonna go listen to the one Imagine Dragons song that I still like.
The, spin-in-in-in-in thing. Bro.
Yeah, I just heard it.
Stop.
It's shut up.
It's so cringe. It makes me, very uncomfortable. The things vocally he does on here are just so fucking bad sometimes. It's,
Dude, it's mass appeal of the band, and it's just yeah.
Are they even anymore, though?
Dude, I know so many people that love Imagine Dragons.
Really? Still? To this day?
Yeah. It's because it's just unoffensive pop music that's played on the radio.
Yeah, I think... What was it, Bones or something on their last album that was pretty popular? I guess maybe they still have some hits.
People who like H.A.R. like Imagine Dragons, and unfortunately, it's just the world we live in.
Yeah, and those two bands have never been more similar, I think. This really reminded me of H.A.R. at a lot of points. And it's weird, because I've always felt like these guys remind me more of Coldplay. And that's not exactly a compliment, given what I do or don't like about Coldplay, but... that's always the comparison that I've drawn, is they're, slightly worse Coldplay. But, now they're, basically just AJR, but the lead singer sounds like an adult.
Coldplay is dropping in October, oh no.
Yeah, they sure are. Dude, Take Me to the Beach, maybe, worst song of the year. So obnoxious.
Sorry, I zoned out because this album was so mid.
I don't know if mid is even the right descriptor for it. It's offensive to me. It's so obnoxious, man. I fucking cannot, brother.
I think they've been worse music. This sucks. Don't get me wrong. It's fucking terrible.
What do you think is worse? Because you are more recent than I am, like I said.
Origins and Evolve?
Okay. Yeah.
Plug in my score.
Origins might be worse. I don't know, but it doesn't get that much worse for me, honestly. I understand this as a 40, but I don't really know where any of those points are coming from. I'm not gonna lie to you, man. This drives me fucking crazy.
I dropped a 30 on it.
You just wanted to get into scores?
The least amount of time we spend on this.
Before we do that, the fucking dubstep drop on Eyes Closed. What?
Bro, this album, it's just a snooze fest.
It blew my mind. I'm so lost.
I think it's just been so long since you've had to listen to something this bad, in this genre. Because this is just a snooze fest.
I felt like it was actively cringe, and that's not something I've ever gotten from Imagine Dragons before.
Oh, really? Dude, that's been my whole experience.
Oh, really?
I've been a hater since day one.
I think a lot of their music is boring.
I'm not even gonna lie to you. Eyes Closed, I could probably find two or three tracks on every album that sounds like that.
But it's got the fucking 2006 dubstep drop. That's not...
Yeah, they do that shit all the time. I don't even know what to tell you.
I don't even know. Maybe they do. I haven't listened to...
They do. It's their signature move.
That... No.
Same with the first track, Wake Up.
No, I'm thinking about it with the other ones. Dude, I don't know. Maybe I'm just unfamiliar or something. Maybe I'm just forgetting.
I think your brain's forcing you to forget, and I think you should let it.
Maybe I'm forgetting for my own protection. What I will say is Fire in These Hills is a valid song to exist. It's fine.
Hot take alert.
I want to put that out there that that song is okay.
That's probably where all the 50s are coming from.
Yeah. Honestly, I gave that one a 7 out of 10 as like a semi-closer, I guess, because you still have that remix that doesn't need to exist at the end there. As a way to close the album off, it's like at least I'm walking away with something in my mind about this album that I did actually appreciate.
It is the best track on the album.
Yeah, I hate that they have the capability to make songs that are actually good like that, and then they choose to make fucking whatever the rest of this is.
I think Radioactive is still probably fun, but then Catchy just overplayed now. But
I mean, like I said, I like Wrecked. I like Bleeding Out is a good song. Demons is a good song.
No.
All right, now we've lost the plot. My score on here is a 29%.
29? That's fair.
Yeah. What'd you go with?
A 30.
30? Okay, well. I suppose we kind of came to these conclusions for different reasons, but we're here nonetheless. We're pretty much exactly at the same spot. Well, let's get a quick return to form here. Hiatus, Kaiyote, Love Heart Cheat Code. You don't make friends, you recognize it, yeah. Oh, wow. Love Heart Cheat Code. Love Heart Cheat Code. Temple to release the pressure. Did you love this?
Did you cheat code this?
Did I cheat code this?
Love Heart Cheat Code.
Yeah. Oh, I see what you did there. That took me a second.
I loved this album. This is really, really good.
Yeah, I love this album too.
This might be one of my favorites of the week.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely... God, what can I even say, dude? It's such a good week aside from the two dog shit albums. But either way, I absolutely love this. And I think that my life would be consistently better if every time I woke up in the morning I just started playing this.
Yeah, dude.
It just makes me feel good, dude. It's such a nice sounding album. It's so sweet, dude. Oh my god, it's so lovable.
It's so annoying that there's like this much good at the same time, because like our list is gonna look fucked.
Yeah,
it's gonna be like, all right, well, 1, 2, and 3 are, and 4 are tied.
Yeah, dude, no, this is amazing. This could have been top of so many weeks that we've done too. It's got such harsh competition this week, and I think that it is a terrible shame that it's gotten kind of overshadowed with how much came out this week. Because
it's only got 385 ratings. It should have more.
This isn't my album of the year, but it needs to be more people's album of the year, because I feel like a lot of those people who would pick it just haven't heard it, just because it was down the list a ways, you know?
Yeah.
Just sounds so sweet. The instrumentals are so whimsical. I love how the vocalist sounds. She's awesome. The lyrics are all like fucking strange and magical and crazy and stuff, dude. It's so cool.
And then you got tracks like Cinnamon Temple, which just assault you a little bit.
Yeah,
it's so good. I'm not gonna lie, Cinnamon Temple is one of my favorite tracks. It's really hard to talk about albums like this because just like
right, the whole time you're listening to it, it's just so pleasurable of an experience, but walking away it's a little hard to describe. I will throw out a little bit of a weird take. I don't really like that those last two tracks are as abrasive as they are. I feel like the title track would have been a perfect closing, and then those two could have been really great singles. I do look at them separately because they're so loud and noisy in comparison. Everything before that point is relaxing and like sweet, and those ones sound kind of crazy, and they're just really like aggressive that way, you know?
Yeah, that's what I love about it though, is that it wakes you up when you're on your way out of the album. It's like, all right,
that's fair.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. And I like both of those songs, but I
appreciate them in the context of the album.
I think that that's equally valid. It does make it a more dynamic experience, I suppose.
Yeah.
Do you think that the last one is my least favorite, though, anyways? Like, it's kind of got MIA vibes, which is cool. I don't know. Were you picking up on that at all?
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah.
Okay, so as much as I appreciate the last two tracks, Cinnamon Temple was my favorite, and White Rabbit was probably my least favorite, but it's still good.
Really? Cinnamon Temple was your favorite across this whole thing?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I know.
I can't argue with it, but I don't agree, I guess.
It's okay to be wrong.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm about to fuck with you.
Vice versa. yeah, no reverse card.
Ooh.
If I'm gonna pick a favorite, dude, like, I think honestly it's the It's the title track. I love that one so much.
That's totally fair. They're all so, like, so close to each other.
Yeah, and Make Friends is so sweet, though, too. Ah! I love the lyrics of that one in particular.
It is.
Oh, my God. So nice.
BMO is beautiful. It's the best track. We can all agree on that.
To an extent, I suppose. I love that it's here. Like, everything about this album is so weird, and the fact that you just have BMO from Adventure Time just in here, like, the voice actor anyways, of course, but, you know... So wonderfully weird.
No, it's canon.
It's canon. I don't know. Did Hiatus Kaiyote ever do, like, Adult Swim things or something? Because I feel like they do kind of feel like part of that world.
I don't know. But I do know that Adventure Time was on Cartoon Network.
Well, yeah, I know. That's what I was thinking is, like, how did these worlds intersect? Like, how did this happen? But at the same time, it kind of makes sense, you know?
I can't find anything saying that they appeared on anything Adult Swim.
Maybe they did soundtrack stuff for Adventure Time or something. I have no idea how this happened.
It would have popped up. I thought.
It's so crazy that it did, and I love that it did. And then Long Cat, as the owner of a very long cat, that is now the anthem.
Hell yeah. Long Cat Gang.
It's so cute. Such a nice, sweet little song. Honestly, like, that ends up being my third favorite, just because I'm like, dude, somebody made this a song. It's short and it's simple, but it's like, oh, I love it. I love it.
It's so good. Also, fuck these critics.
Oh, dude, yeah. What?
Fuck all these 50s and 60s. What the hell?
Yeah, that actually makes me a little angry. Again, and we keep kind of shitting on other people's opinions, which is not exactly what I want to do. I don't want to make that a thing.
I love it.
And I think that attacking people over their opinions is a bullshit thing to do. But...
No, that's bullshit.
But Slant Magazine, but, hey guys, you're ops now. Slant Magazine is ops.
Yeah, we can bully other large people. Not the person reviewing. Charles, this album wasn't for you, but Slant Magazine, fuck you.
Honestly, this quote here can't help but register as psychedelia for dummies. Brother, have fun with something, please. Some people aren't gonna get it though. Some people aren't gonna see the vision. Would you end up scoring this?
What'd you end up scoring this?
Why do you need to know that?
I gotta do math.
Why do you need to know that?
I gotta do math.
I gave it an 87.
I gotta do math.
87.
You go to what? 87?
Yes.
I gave it an 89.
89. Fuck yeah, dude. We're at an 88. Very good album, deserving of that score entirely, as far as I'm concerned, dude.
Hell yeah.
That is awesome.
All right, now for the worst album.
I sure hope you don't mean that. Impossible Light by Uboa. That's where we're at, I do believe, right? Say psych right now.
No. Psych. No, this is so good. I was killing people in the ball temple in Baldur's Gate 3 while this was on, and I'm like, this is the perfect context for something like this.
This is terrifying in the best possible way.
Yeah.
Oh, dude. I remember listening to The Origin of My Depression by Uboa several years ago and thinking pretty similar things about that, but I don't know what the album in between that and this is, so I don't know how to describe the progression, but this feels like that album taken to an even higher level to me. Have you listened to any other Uboa?
No, I was too busy listening to this album.
Yeah, that makes sense.
This one's actually my favorite out of the week.
You know, it's my second favorite, but it's extremely close, so it might as well be.
It's your second favorite.
It's my second favorite.
What was your favorite out of the...
Well, we'll get there. We'll get there. Well, you already know. It's the Lil Yachty album. We already discussed that. The James Blake,
right.
Lil Yachty. Yeah. Yeah, that was a 96. Things aren't going to pass that. Not regularly, anyways. But I gotta say, I did think about it. This might as well be perfect.
You're telling me this isn't a 10 for you?
It might as well be.
I heard this album and I'm like, well, Shiloh's got a third 10 coming.
I don't know if I've lived with it long enough to decide that fully, because it's kind of a hard one to choose to turn on. You have to be willing to not only sit down and listen to music for the next 40 minutes and just like do nothing else, you have to be willing to scare yourself shitless and also be doing it at the same time.
Yeah, dude, the Murder Temple, listening to this, I was like, this is exactly what they'd fucking play in the Murder Temple.
Yeah, is that like a spooky section of the game? I'm not exactly familiar.
It's not necessarily spooky, more so as that's just where they worship the god of murder, so they do that by murdering.
That's badass.
They just enjoy murder quite a bit, in blood.
This does kind of sound like murder, so...
And blood. Yeah.
And blood. Murder and blood.
Weaponized dysphoria.
My notes for that song, I just have a whole bunch of times. Just like held down the A key. The harshest fucking thing I've ever heard in my life. And I do believe that's actually true.
Harsher than Woodpecker number 5 or whatever the fuck. Mambo number 5.
Mambo number 5. You know, is it harsher than harsh noise music? Maybe.
No.
It might be harsher than harsh noise music.
It's not, because this is...
It basically is harsh noise music, though, at the same time. Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
This crosses the line into music.
Yeah, right. This is more music than it is noise, but it definitely is just as harsh as, like, Pulse Demon or whatever else you might want to point at.
Blood of a pomegranate.
Blood of a pomegranate?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who are them?
Who are them?
Who are them? What are they doing here?
Blood of a pomegranate. Oh, is that one of the features on here? I was trying to remember. Yeah.
Yeah. How do you fucking manage to have features on an album like this, and why is it good?
I don't know. Oh, is that the feature on the last song? I just forgot to write it down.
No, it is the feature on the fourth track.
Yeah, I don't really know if a feature was necessary on Gordian Worm, but I mean, it works, so I'll take it. Like, it's amazing. It's all amazing. Like, everything's amazing.
The feature on the last track, by the way, was Ote colon O-N-I-I.
Yeah, okay. I just wasn't familiar with any of the names, so I was getting mixed up on what was what. We want to talk about a slightly more notable feature. That closing track is some of the craziest shit I've ever fucking heard in my life.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite tracks probably ever.
Yeah, I think it is my favorite song on here, and it's quite possibly one of the best songs I've ever heard.
So long. It's just salty.
Is it even?
It's 9.
Yeah, oh wow, it's 9 minutes?
I mean, technically it's 2 tracks?
I mean, it's split, yeah, but...
Oh, hey, Ote Ani is dropping an album in September, if you want to check it out.
Fucking sure, why not, dude? Doing this whole, like, weird little spoken word poetry thing, and then it's just crazy noises
chimes.
Behind it. Yeah.
My ears are being assaulted by chimes.
Yeah, dude, it's amazing. So amazing. It is really just like something that will be assaulting your ears the entire time, but I don't think that that's a bad thing at all. Sometimes you need something to do that. And the lyrics on here are so like crazy sad, but it really just fits in side by side.
Never translated the... Oh, fuck. What Asian language is this?
I'm not sure. I wasn't necessarily just referring to that track. I was just talking in general about the album, talking a lot about, like, dysphoria and... Yeah, just...
Yeah, I just forgot to translate the track.
Yeah, I did at one point, and I'm trying to remember what that was all about.
It's Chinese. Okay, I figured it out. I don't know. Anyways.
Yeah, no, I did definitely like what was being said on there. I'm blanking on it right now in the moment here. I'm a little bit out of sorts, if that wasn't obvious at any point before now.
Yeah, I'll just send you the lyrics, because I don't know how to word this. That is the lyrics for Impossible Light Golden Flower. This is like some swans type shit.
It really is. It's like a fucking religious experience.
Yeah, dude. New swans dropped.
Yeah, no. Uboa seems like a very singular artist in that way, too. Like, I don't think I can get this sort of thing anywhere besides the other Uboa album that I've heard, and even that wasn't as harsh as this, I don't think.
The only way you could even, like, get the same experience listening to this album through your headphones is being at a swan show.
This needs to be something stupid loud, so yeah.
I can only imagine being at a Uboa show.
That's probably fucking amazing. I mean, I have no idea if she does shows, but...
Alright, I'll see if she's on tour.
Some people just don't in this kind of...
Yeah.
...era of music, but...
Apparently she does.
I'd be so down, actually, because that sounds terrifying, but amazing, just like this album.
She does, like, 1 or 2 shows a year.
Ah, that's a shame, but...
Is she Australian?
I have no idea. Okay. Okay, yeah.
All right.
That makes sense. There's so much to say, and yet it's kind of hard to decide what to say about it. Yeah? You think so? Is that how you feel?
I think so. Yep.
All right. Well, that's, it's good to know, I suppose. Really, just at every twist and turn of this album, like, there's something else going on that's so crazy. It really leaves you wondering what's gonna come next. I noticed watching back my Shushu reaction, there's parts during that album, like, the freakiest parts of that album, I'm just, like, trying to, like, fucking crinkle up into a little ball and hide. That was me listening to this album the whole way through.
Same. Doing it while, like... playing a video game too, I'm just like, what the fuck?
That sounds...
This is really cool boss music.
That sounds like a fucking overstimulation recipe right there.
It was awesome.
That sounds awesome. Well, do we have anything else to say about it? Any other track you wanted to point out or anything?
The cover is what you do when you listen to this album.
Yeah, precisely. I would agree.
I landed on a 96.
96? A 96 and a 95. So there we are. We both gave a 96 this week.
Yeah, I never even thought about that.
Yeah, I was much closer to yours than...
Why are you copying?
It's just... that's just what I do, don't you know? Let's go to the rankings for the week. oh my god, the gap is hilarious. And I mean, it was just naturally going to be. But we have Camila Cabello coming in last at a 21.5%. And then not too far above, Imagine Dragons with Loom at 29.5%. And then we have a tie with Hiatus Kaiyote, Love Heart Cheat Code, and Lupe Fiasco Samurai, both at an 88%. And then we have at the second place for the week, James Blake and Lil Yachty, Bad Cameo, at a 93%.
Good cameo.
Very good cameo. And then our top for the week, maybe our top consensus in general. Oh no, Jack Name still is, but we have Impossible Light by Uboa at a 95.5%.
Hell yeah.
So that's about it. If you did get to this point in the podcast, you probably liked it. So if you wouldn't mind at all, go ahead and drop a like on the video. And you can subscribe to the channel for more music-related content coming your way. Micah, do you have anything to say to the people before we get on out of here?
Dinner.
That's pretty wholesome. And we'll see you next time.